Writing CSS can be tricky. Getting everything to look just right across different browsers and devices is no small feat. But don't worry, I've got you covered. In this video, I'll share my top 5 tips and techniques to make your CSS cleaner, more efficient, and easier to maintain. So if you're ready, fire up your favorite editor and let's code. Part of the allure of preprocessors like SAS is the ability to nest style rules. Luckily for us, nesting has come to vanilla CSS. Nesting creates style blocks that streamline and organize style sheets, with the added bonus of reducing the number of classes you'll need to come up with. The result is cleaner HTML and more maintainable style sheets. For example, here I have a simple nav element with an unordered list. Each list item contains a link, and I've given each element a class name. Even with this simple nav, the HTML and style sheet starts to become cluttered and less easy to read. If you add on top of that styles for a secondary navigation, then things really start to become tedious and hard to maintain. Instead, I'll remove all of the class names except for the class secondary navigation. I'll select the nav element and nest all of its descendant styles inside. I can even nest styles for the hover and focus states. For reference, all of these nested styles are equivalent to this. So this means that any anchor elements outside of the nav element will not be affected by these rules, like these anchor tags in the body. One benefit of nesting is that it naturally organizes your style sheet by component. At a glance, I can tell that this style block controls the layout and design of the navigation elements. This block controls the style for buttons, this one for the hero section, and so on. An added bonus is that nesting saves me from having to come up with a ton of different semantic class names. And when you're trying to quickly put together a project, this can really save a lot of time. Nesting is now supported in the latest versions of all major browsers, so definitely give this one a go. Text overflow is one of the most common issues I run into, and one of the easiest to fix. This usually happens when you try to fit really large font sizes, here this heading is 7rem, into smaller viewports. Everything looks great until you hit a mobile view, until the text overflows its parent and causes the layout to break. An easy way to fix this is to use the clamp function. With the clamp function, you can create responsive typography that scales up and down based on the viewport width. The clamp function takes in 3 values, a minimum, a preferred, and a maximum font size. Essentially, you're setting a range of acceptable values for font sizes to transition between. The preferred value, set in viewport widths, will be used as long as it's between the minimum and maximum. If the preferred value is smaller than the minimum, then the minimum will be used. If the preferred value is larger than the maximum, then the maximum will be used. And like magic, you've created fluid typography, all without using media queries. I prefer to set them up as custom properties in my project template, which makes starting new projects super quick. There's tons more that the clamp function can do, like creating relative responsive padding and margin. If you're interested in learning more about clamp, check the link in the description. You always want to make sure you're providing the best experience for your users. An easy win is to serve appropriately sized images for all viewports. All too often, I see code bases that use media queries and the display property to hide and show images at different breakpoints. Often, this results in unnecessary and difficult to maintain markup. Instead, get rid of the mess and use the picture element. Here I have 2 images, a smaller square version for mobile and a higher res rectangular version for desktop. The picture element uses 1 image element, here I'll specify the mobile version as the image source, and any amount of source elements. In this case, I'll set the desktop image as the source set. You can add as many source elements as you want. The browser will choose the best source option based on the given media condition. If there isn't a match or the picture element isn't supported by the browser, the image element is used instead. Here, I'll set the media condition to viewports wider than 768 pixels, or 48rem. Take a look when I adjust the viewport. You can see the different images depending on the size. The picture element is not only handy for serving users optimized images, it also gives you more control over art direction and can provide a fallback for browsers that don't serve modern image formats like WebP. The picture element has been baseline widely available since 2016, so try this one out today. Grid and Flexbox are two powerful layout tools that you should become familiar with if you're writing CSS at any level. But if I had to choose just one to learn as a beginner, I always suggest starting with Grid, since it can be easier to visualize. Take this image card component as an example. It's a simple div that contains an image element and two paragraphs. I wrap the paragraphs in a div to make styling easier. There are many ways to style this card, but the easiest I've found is to use Grid. To start, I'll change the card's display to grid. To make things easier, I'll switch on the grid lines in DevTools. Now I'll use these lines to place content anywhere in the grid. Using the grid column and grid rows properties, I'll specify the starting and stopping grid lines where I want my image to occupy. Then I'll do the same for the caption. Lastly, I'll add some padding to the caption to make it sit nicely within the card. I've also created a version of this card using positioning. But in my opinion, using grid makes it easier to understand how this card is being laid out. At a glance, you can easily tell where the content lives. And if you needed help visualizing the layout, you can always switch on the grid in DevTools. The same can't really be said about positioned elements. There's much more you can do with grid. Check out the link in the description to the video where I create a flexible grid. Sometimes I find that I need more granular control over how components like cards change their layouts with the viewport. This is where container queries comes in. Container queries allow you to query the size of a container and apply styles to its descendants. It's declared using an at rule, just like a media query. Take these two cards, for example. At a certain point, the text starts to shift the height of the card. And because the length of the two paragraphs is different, the height of the cards shift at different times. So instead of using the viewport and arbitrary breakpoints to fix this layout, I'll use the width of its container instead. First, I'll declare the container property on the card container class. I'll specify a name for the container and that I want the browser to query the inline size or the container's width. I'll start my container query by declaring an @container rule. I'll specify the container I want to query and give it a media condition. To fix the height issue, I'll change the width of the columns in the card and switch the image's position property to relative to bring it back into the bounds of its parent. I can add another @container rule for when the card is less than 400 pixels. Here, I'll add rows to the grid, align the text to the center, and remove the gap. I'll change the positioning of the image back to absolute to pop it back out of the bounds of its parent. I'll place it in the top row and make sure it extends from the first to last grid lines of the column. Finally, I'll give the content some padding and place it in the proper columns and rows. And just like media queries, you can nest container queries to keep the styles for this card component organized within the same block. And those are the top 5 CSS tips and techniques that I can't live without. I use them in nearly every project and highly recommend you do too. If you'd like to learn more about any of these tips, check out the links in the description. And don't forget to share your favorite tips in the comments below. Thanks for watching, and stay tuned for more CSS builds.